Welcome to Protea Valley Church Online. We are delighted that you have joined us this morning. We are in our sermon series called Grace, What Have You Done? And this morning we'll be looking at Galatians chapter 2 as we discover what freedom in Jesus means. Our teenagers are also looking at Galatians, so please go check out our Flavored by Faith YouTube channel. Or you can find the teen videos on our Protea Valley Church website or on the Facebook page. At the end of the service, there will be a QR code especially for visitors. If that's you, or if you'd like to find out more information, please make use of this QR code. We would love to get connected with you. And if you're watching this live this morning, then please, I'd love to invite you to our live stream chat directly after the service. It's a great opportunity to connect and to ask for prayer requests or to continue our discussion further with the freedom of Jesus and what it means. But before we go further, I would love to pray for us. Lord Jesus, thank you that during these strange times, you are still in control. Sorry for the times where we have lost sight of you and we haven't put you first, Lord. Please continue to show us your grace and your mercy. And may we rely on you, particularly in uncertain times, always. Thank you that freedom in Jesus means that while we are aware that we don't deserve any of your love and goodness, you changed that by dying on the cross for us. May we know this is our freedom, and may we live it out every single day. Amen. And so we're going to go into a time of worship together, followed by the continuation of the sermon series. But won't you stand with me now as we sing together?
Hey Protea Valley, so we love hearing testimonies from you guys, and so this week we're going to be hearing from Lizanne Victor. Some of you may remember probably about 6 weeks ago, I think it was, she shared what it's like to be a health worker on the forefront of COVID, and some things have changed since then. And Lizanne just has a beautiful and powerful testimony about how she's found God in the very difficult season that she found herself in. Thanks, Lizanne.
Good morning, Church. I'm Lizanne Victor. I'm a surgeon currently working at Karl Bremer Hospital. A few weeks ago, Grant asked me to share something with the Church about our preparation and work surrounding the COVID-19 pandemic. But today, I'm going to share my personal journey with COVID-19 with you. A few weeks ago, I became symptomatic, and I was convinced that it was just the flu, but being a healthcare worker, I had myself tested. And then 5 hours later, I was informed that my test was actually positive. I was extremely shocked by this and very emotional. And it raised a lot of questions. I was scared and I was wondering, what part of the statistics am I? Am I going to be ventilated? Where will I go if I need ventilation? Am I going to die? And yes, who did I put at risk? Is my family going to be okay? And so many other questions. And yes, I was feeling unwell and isolated. And in the midst of this, you become very much aware of your insecurities. So I was really scared and anxious and vulnerable. And yes, in this state of being vulnerable, I became really aware of the fact that although I'm isolated, I'm not alone. And God's presence in that isolation room was real. And that gave me a sense of being in God's presence, although I wasn't sure how things will turn out. But yes, I'm well, I'm back at work. And my whole body wants to shout with joy and just praise and thank God for his faithfulness and his healing. And for the fact that my family didn't contract COVID and my team was also fine at work. I'm still emotional thinking about it. And some of the things that I've learned about myself is that at this stage, I really want to live. And yes, I have a lot of things to be grateful for. And I'm very much aware of the fact that I want to be able to touch and be close to the people that I love. Throughout this time of isolation, I was very much aware of the fact that as Christians, God blesses us to be a blessing to others. And I really pray that through this time of the COVID pandemic, that God will help us find innovative ways to really be a blessing to others. Thank you.
So welcome back to our series around Galatians. So we've been preaching through Paul's letter to Galatia. This is week 2 of 6 weeks. The question that we're asking each week is, grace, what have you done? And the answer to the question today is, given us freedom. The grace of God has given us an outrageous freedom, a freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. So a little bit of background to some of you who may not join us last week. Paul is writing to this very young church in Galatia. They've just found great freedom in Christ. And some outsiders look at this, and in verse 4 it says, they came in to spy on the freedom that we have in Christ. And so they came into the church and they began to bring in some rules and regulations. It was a group of Jewish believers came in and said, in order to be a Christian, you need to follow some of the Jewish rituals, and including circumcision and the way you eat and a whole bunch of stuff. And they began to steal away the freedom that the people of God had. And so with some passion, Paul writes into that situation. But look out for verse 20 and 21 as Julie reads for us, because that's really where the tacky hits the tar. And so thanks, Julie, as you read for us.
Then, after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. I took Titus along also. I went in response to a revelation, and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders, I presented to them the gospel that I preach among the Gentiles. I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. We, who are Jews by birth and not sinful Gentiles, know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. But if in seeking to be justified in Christ, we Jews find ourselves also among the sinners, doesn't that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, then I really would be a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing.
So let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, once again, it's so good to be here today. I just love the fact that we get together as Christian community and we get to spend time worshiping together. We get to spend time in your word, Lord. Your word is just beautiful. Thank you that you've given it to us. That scripture was breathed in order to shape and change our lives. It wasn't just for information. It wasn't that we could just have an intellectual discussion. But scripture was given to us to teach us on the one hand, but also to shift and change our hearts and our lives. And so that is really, really my prayer. Holy Spirit, that you would be so present that as I speak, that you would take these words that come out of my mouth and that you would just use it in the hearts and lives of everyone sharing in the service. That you would reach into their hearts and help them to make it their own. That it would shift some of their attitudes, but some of their behaviors. And perhaps most importantly, it would draw them closer to Christ. That they would see themselves and experience themselves more free because of today's message. And so give us ears to hear your word, give us hearts to understand it, and give us eyes to see Jesus at work in our lives and in our world. Amen. So I'm not sure about you, but I went to school to play sport. The academic side wasn't of too much interest to me. I just loved sport. I ate, drank, and slept sport. But there was one aspect of sport that I didn't enjoy, and that was when we'd just have an informal game of hockey or whatever it was, or rugby or soccer, and they would choose two guys out of the crowd and appoint them the two team captains. All the guys would stand around in a bunch, and then each captain would have a chance to call someone out and put them on their team. And for all the uncool kids like me, there was this dread that you would be the last man standing. I mean, how embarrassing is that, and how chuffed you were if you were one of the first ones that were chosen. But there's just something unfair about that process, and I just hate seeing it when I see it take place in my own children's lives. But I think there was something of that unfairness that Paul was addressing in his letter to Galatians. So there was clearly an in crowd in the church, and they were people of Jewish descent, And they were coming in and they were kind of speaking to the not in crowd, which was just about everybody else, basically, all the other Galatians that weren't Jewish. And they were saying to them, if you want to be in with us, then you need to follow these rules and these rituals and these ceremonies. But at the heart of what they were saying is, this is what got Paul really angry, is they were saying, if you want to be in with God, then you need to do these things. If you want to be accepted by God, then you need to follow the law. And so this got Paul's blood boiling, because he knew that it cost Jesus his own blood. It cost him his life in order to win freedom for all his followers. And so he addresses this enthusiastically and passionately. So I just want you to reflect on that question, perhaps, as we go into this message, is what is it that we need to do to find freedom in Christ? What is it that we need to do to please God? Just a moment for you to reflect on that. So there's a guy called Tertullian. He was probably one of the first Christian authors. He was probably one of the first Christian apologists after Paul himself. He was one of the leaders in the early church. He just wrote some really amazing stuff, if you ever come across these things. But he had a concept called the two thieves of the gospel, the two thieves of the gospel. And he wrote this: just as Christ was crucified between two thieves, so the doctrine of justification is ever crucified between two opposite errors. Let me just read that again. Just as Christ was crucified between two thieves, so this doctrine of justification is ever crucified between two opposite errors. So I used the word justified there. Now, if you paid attention to the text, you would have seen that the word justified comes up quite a bit in Galatians chapter 2. To try and describe what what justification means would probably be in a sermon in itself. But the shortest version that I can give to you is, justification means to be put in right standing with someone else. And let me use an illustration from our own lives to explain what I mean by that. So many years ago, we got a phone call from school to say that one of our children was in big trouble because he had stuffed a spider in another boy's mouth. Yes, you heard me right. So our son comes home, and of course we sit him down and we need to have a tough chat about this. And so my son justifies himself. And how does he do that? Well, he tells us what really happened. He says that one of his best friends was being bullied, and he told the guy to get off. It was a bigger boy. He didn't get off. And so he got involved. He got the guy off his friend, pinned him on the ground, and there was a tuft of grass just next to this boy's face. And so he grabbed this tuft of grass, and he doesn't know why, but he stuffed it in his mouth. And got up and walked away. And this boy had thought that he'd picked up a spider and stuffed it in his mouth, and he just freaked out completely and went straight to the teacher. And of course my son got into a lot of trouble. As my son explained what had happened, he was justifying himself. He was putting himself in right connection with Liesl and myself. He was restoring the relationship. So of course his behavior hadn't changed, but our perception, our view of the behavior had changed. And that's exactly what happens in justification, in our relationship with God. We're placed in right standing, in right relationship with God, because of what Jesus has done. Now, Tertullian was saying that just like these were two thieves who were crucified on either side of Jesus, so there are two thieves on the opposite side, on either side of the gospel of grace, that take something away from the gospel, take something away from the acceptance that we have in Christ, take something away from the freedom that we have. And what makes these two errors so powerful, I suspect, is that they are evident in probably all of our lives in some degree or another. And so perhaps you just need to pay some attention to these two and to be reflective as I share what they are. And so the two thieves, on the one hand, could be called moralism or legalism, and on the other hand, liberalism and relativism. And so I found this image that will be helpful to explain what I mean. So in the middle, you have Christ crucified. We will come back to what that means. On the one side, you have legalism or moralism. Now, that's a faith where you believe that right behavior is what gets you closer to God. You need to behave in the right manner to please God. God is holy. He doesn't tolerate sin, and yet I am sinful. And so I need to be better behaved. I need to do the right things. I need to follow a set of rules in order for me to be in right standing with God. Maybe it's I need to pray more, or I need to go to church more, or I need to tell other people about Jesus, or I need to be just more good. I don't know what your weakness is. For me, my own weakness, I reflected over this over the last couple of weeks, is that I realize that I've got this attitude that if I'm not grateful and thankful enough, God will take away what I have. I don't know where it comes from. It's a deep underlying thing that I suddenly cottoned onto a couple of weeks ago. It's like the sense that if I'm not grateful enough, God will kind of just take it away from me. Of course, it's illogical, it's irrational, but it's a form of legalism or moralism. And so I'm definitely on that side of the spectrum at the moment. On the other side, you have liberalism or relativism. Now, this is a faith that says God is loving, which of course he is. So to please God, all I need to do is to behave in a loving manner. I just need to be a good person. Life is messy, and there are no clear rights or wrongs, but if you just follow the rule of love, everything will be okay. Their anthem is, it's love that makes the world go round. Which one of those two thieves do you find yourself submitting to? Truth be told, we're all somewhere on that continuum at some points in our lives, and maybe there's a sense of a swing that we go through at different points in our faith journey. But of course, both those thieves don't do what the cross does, and that is set us free. The cross of Christ, which he purchased with his own blood, with his own life, is one that sets us free. It is a powerful and significant work. It's a work that transforms our lives. It justifies us and causes God to accept us. So now we get to the steak in the meal. Apology to the vegetarians out there, and that's Christ crucified. And so I want to read again verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Paul goes on to say, the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. What is Paul saying? Well, he's saying that when I hand the rights of my life over to Jesus, when I become a Christ follower, when I am justified, remember, justified means being put in right standing with someone, then through the cross, I am put in right relationship with God. I am put in right standing with God the Father. What that means is when God the Father looks at you and I, he looks at us in the same way that he looks at his son Jesus. He treats us in the same way he treats his son Jesus. He loves us in the same way that he loves his own son Jesus. He sees us as having died to our sinfulness, just as Christ died. And he sees us as having found life, just as Christ rose from the dead 3 days later. So we are crucified, we are dead to our sinfulness and our brokenness and everything about our lives that is dark and rebellious from God. We've died to that, and we are risen in Christ to be alive, fully alive, eternally alive. At the moment of our salvation, God sees us in that way. Father God treats us like he treats his own son Jesus. Now this is massive if we begin to live this out, and it is a faith journey that leads to unbelievable freedom. So, a reminder, we don't follow a set of rules on the one hand. We don't all get wishy-washy and all lovey-dovey on the one hand and just sit back and just enjoy the ride. On the other hand, there is something that we need to do to be part of this process. And Paul goes on to write about it in that next line. He says, the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God. So there's some living that needs to be done. I need to live out and walk in the freedom that Christ has won for me. I have to walk in the acceptance that God the Father gives to me. I have to walk in the love that he showers out and pours out into my life. And it's a walking that requires a transformation of every part of who I am. It's a transformation, a change in my attitudes, in my values, in my behaviors, in my thoughts, in my relationships, in absolutely everything. I need transforming. So how do we partner with God in this transformation process? And I'd like to get really practical and just mention just very briefly three attitudes or three things that I think are helpful in this partnership. They are to be humble, to be bold, and to be a firefighter. To be humble, to be bold, and to be a firefighter. So firstly, to be humble. So the first thing I do is that I humbly recognize that I am a sinner. I am. In fact, the longer I journey with Jesus, the more I recognize this. I have followed Christ for over 40 years of my life, and I can say to you now that I'm more aware than ever that I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I need saving every day, every moment of my life. And that humility, I guess, opens up the door for God to do the saving that I need. And so that's the first thing. We are humble, humbly recognize or acknowledge the sinfulness in our lives. But there's a second part of that, and that is we are bold. We are bold because we are deeply loved by our Father. He treats us like His own children. God could not love us more. We are magnificently, extravagantly, and perfectly loved. What that does is it gives me a boldness about the way I live my life. It gives me hope. The God of the universe loves me and He's at work in my life, and so I can live boldly and I can live confidently and I can approach Him boldly and I can approach Him confidently in order to help me in times of need and times of challenge and times of temptation. So I'm humble, I'm bold, and I'm a firefighter. Now, I got this thought from a series that we've been watching on TV, Chicago Fire. Some of you may have watched it. And there's a particular scene that stuck out in my head, and that is next to the fire truck, there's this pile of clothes. There's the firefighters' boots, and there's sort of their dungaree thing just put kind of hung over. Let's put an image up to help us in the process. Sort of a dungaree that's hung over the boot. And so when that alarm sounds, the firefighters run to the truck, and they simply plant their feet in the boots, and while they're standing there, they just pull up this dungaree over them, and within a split second, they are ready to tackle whatever fire they will be fighting. That's how we are meant to handle life and our shortcomings. We're meant to step into Jesus. We're meant to quite literally put Him on. We're meant to quite literally put Jesus on. In next week's chapter, which Brent will be dealing with, Paul writes, clothing yourself with Christ. I don't want to steal Brent's thunder, but just a little bit out of next week. A taster for you to come back. Clothing yourself with Christ. And in Romans, which many believe is what Paul wrote after his letter to Galatians, he says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And so for me, this is the biggest takeaway out of today. If we are to live truly free, if we are to embrace what grace has done for us, then we are to literally step into Christ. In the moments in our lives when we are challenged, when we are tempted, when we are afraid, when we are anxious, when anything is going on in the messiness of our world in our lives, then the best thing that we can do is literally to have this mental image of stepping into Jesus, stepping into His life, stepping into His power, stepping into His relationship with God, the Father. It's something we can do at the start of each day, and it's something that can populate every moment of every day of our lives. And so I want you to take that one image away with you out of today's message. Step into Jesus and find the freedom. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Let's pray together. Even as I stand here, Lord, I almost get goosebumps. Those are just such powerful words, Lord Jesus, that we get to live in You. We get to literally step into You, Lord, and find strength and find courage and find victory over temptation and find the fruit of the Spirit that causes us just to have different attitudes and to treat people differently and just to approach life in a whole different way. I just thank You, that, Lord Jesus, that You really have done it all on the cross. I really thank You, Lord, that I don't have to follow a whole bunch of rules and regulations. And would You set me free, Lord, from the tendency that I sometimes have to stand in front of that thief on that cross. And for others of us, Lord Jesus, who tend to be a bit more relativist and a little less focused on truth and more on love, Lord Jesus, help us not to stand in front of that thief, but to all stand before You today, Jesus, and to find the joy and the freedom that we have in You, and the transformation that Your work on the cross does in our hearts and in our lives. Lord, we look forward to living in You more freely in this next season of our lives. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Holy Spirit, and come and work in us. And Father, be blessed and pleased and honored by us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
The word communion has as its source the sense of community. And so on one hand, we are gathered together in all our different places, as many other churches will gather around the world today, and as a community that loves Jesus, who elevates Jesus, who worships Jesus, we are going to break bread and drink wine together. But even more important than community, because some of you I know are meeting alone today, even more than our communion with each other, which we so dearly miss each week, is the reality of our communion with God. And so this is a meal that Jesus has prepared, and he is the host. He is drawing us into a meal. It's an invitation to fellowship and friendship with God himself. And so as we come to break bread together, let's pray and give thanks as Jesus did on that night. So let's bow our heads and pray. Jesus, we give you thanks for fellowship and friendship within the body of Christ. And even though we can't meet in the season, we want to give you thanks for technology that allows us to connect together. But more than that, we want to give you thanks that we can have communion with God himself, that we can know you, Father, and Son, and Spirit, that we can sense your presence and know your blessing. We want to give you thanks that you have been faithful throughout the season, that you have been present in our homes and in our hearts. And so we want to give you thanks for this meal that is a reminder of your continued presence with us. And so as we break this bread and drink of this cup, we are proclaiming your death, Paul writes, until you come again. We believe you're alive, Jesus. We believe that you are active in our world. We believe that you are hearing our prayers. And we believe that you are present in our homes. And so may we sense something of the beauty of your presence with us this morning. Friends, part of our worship as we pray is to confess our sins before we come to this meal. And so let's do that in the quietness for a few moments. Let's just confess quietly some of the ways that we have doubted God over the season. Perhaps we have not held tightly onto his promises. Perhaps there have been areas where we've been disobedient and sinful, greedy and unkind. And so a good place to be is in a place of repentance and confession. And so for a few moments of silence, let's confess our sins to God, who is faithful and just and who will wipe our sins away from us as far as the east is from the west. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross of which this meal reminds us. For at the cross you wipe the slate clean, and we give you thanks and praise that once our sins have been forgiven, they are no more. And so we praise you for the depth of your sacrifice, Jesus, that you did it willingly for sinful people just like us. And we love that about you, that you first loved us. And so all we can do is respond to that. And so we want to respond with our prayers, with our affection, with our time. And so thank you so much for this opportunity we have to respond to your great love poured out to us. And so may this meal remind us of that love. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, would you take your bread and your wine? Would you break the bread and offer it to each other? And when you do that, would you say the words, "This is the body of Christ, which is for you." When you pass the cups to each other, let's just share this meal together. Would you say, "This is the blood of Christ, which is for you." So Paul reminds us, on the night of his arrest, Jesus gave thanks as we have, took bread. He broke the bread and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And so whenever we eat this bread and whenever we drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Friends, this is the body of Christ for you, and this is the blood of Christ for you. Share in this meal together. Let's continue to pray. Jesus, we want to pray for this world. There are so many complexities. I know so many families that are struggling with a lack of income, loss of jobs. Many people are struggling with sleep, anxiety. There are those who have reached the very end of their own personal resources. And so Jesus, my prayer is that in this season of uncertainty and in this season of need, I pray that they would find that you are faithful and that you are enough. And so we ask your blessing and your protection and your provision over them. We pray for wisdom for our president, for his cabinet, for those that are trying to manage this crisis. It's easy from the outside to throw stones and to make judgments, and so we don't want to do that, Lord. We do want to pray for wisdom, pray for sense to prevail in every way, pray for very difficult decisions to be clearer as to what the right answer is when both sides seem to be a lose-lose. And we just pray for wisdom for those who are leading the charge. We pray for those, including those in our own membership who are involved on the very front lines of dealing with this illness. Pray your blessing and protection over them. Pray just over their families, that there would be a sense of peace and that they would put aside worry and that they would know, Jesus, that you are present in the midst of all of this. And we pray for those who have lost and who will lose loved ones over these coming weeks and months. Pray that you would meet them in their grief, that you would be their comfort as you promise in the scriptures to be. And so would you guard and bless us as a church, Lord, as we figure our way through this new season, as we leverage technology and all these other mechanisms. I pray that the gospel would not be contained by this virus, but instead that the church would be liberated and the gospel would find its root in the hearts and the minds of men, women, and children around the world. These seasons of uncertainty cause us to doubt so many things, but often cause us to seek. And my prayer is, Lord, that those who are seeking would find that you are the true answer. And so guard us as your people and bless us, we pray, that we might be a blessing to this world. And we ask this in Jesus' beautiful name. God's people agreed and said, Amen. Let's stand. Let's continue to worship.
Christ.
Guys, it's been absolutely awesome joining with you today. Before I bless you and send you into your week, just a reminder that you can join us for a live chat after the service. You'll find it meaty and meaningful. Brent and myself and Candice will be just chatting through a little bit more about what today's text means for us and for us as a community in South Africa in this time. So don't just dial out, join us a little bit later. And so would you stand with me, perhaps hold out your palms in front of you as an act of receiving. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God your Father, and the friendship and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. Have a great week loving and serving Jesus, and love the freedom that you have in him. Bless you.
Thank you so much for joining us today. You will now see two QR codes on the screen in front of you. The one is if you'd like to give to the missions and ministries of this church. The other is for our visitors. Please make use of this code. We would love to get connected with you. Now, once the service ends, please go onto the latest post on Facebook or YouTube for our live stream chat. We'll be starting in a couple of minutes. This is a great opportunity to interact with some of our leadership team. See you next Sunday, same time, same place. Goodbye.